Alrighty guys, what's up? This is Lightning Hiro coming at you with my, I like the titles that I've been seeing, and I like the idea of the first car that I've been seeing, so I'm going to go ahead and call this. I'm not going to include my name in this. I'm not going to say, like, Tuning with Lightning Hiro. That's just, it's my channel. I like to think that you guys know that it's me that's doing it, so I'm just going to go ahead and ixnay that, and I like the keeping it sideways, so I'm going to officially call the series Keeping It Sideways. It's a tuning tutorial that I will be doing. It'll be this will be comprised of me building cars, explaining why I build and what I choose and why I choose it, and then tuning it the way I tune it, and then etc. All the details will be explained here soon. So the first request I had for a car was a BMW Z4 M Coupe. So I already have one made, so I will go to my garage real quickly. I will select it, and then I will strip it down and rebuild it. Should be about X class 6. There it is. 630 something. So I'll go ahead and upgrade it and then tune it. Reset the tuning. Yes, I want to reset the tuning. Upgrade. Yuck, that was gross. Ugh. Yuck. Okay, so now I think the trickiest thing for me in a BMW is most of the... Now, the Z4 is the exception here with a couple of other cars, but when I pick a car, I try to pick a car with a fairly even power-to-torque curve. And what I mean by that is, look at this motor, you look at the torque curve, and you look at how flat that is. Now, I'm sure most of you understand what this means, but I'll give a little explanation about it. So this torque curve means from 0 RPMs all the way to, looks like about 8,000 RPMs, your torque is going to be about 269 no matter how hard you're flooring it, which is good. You want something like that. Horsepower obviously will kick in as the RPMs rise. So you have the stock engine and the E92 motor. I don't like the E92 motor. I love the sound of the E92 motor, but just for this, I don't want it. So I'm going to keep it with the stock motor. Also, when you build a car, keep in mind the weight distribution. The displacement isn't that big of a deal. It's just, different sound. So, drivetrain swap, yep, all-wheel drive. I'll deal with this later. We'll see where it goes. I don't like the fact that it takes a huge dip in this lower-end torque, so I'll leave that alone. But, like I said with the series, I'm going to go ahead and build from the ground up. So let's go ahead and start with the tires. Now, most of my cars... tire width is not as huge of a component in Forza 4 as it was in Forza 3, meaning that putting 3.0, now, of course, the tire width comes into play depending on how much power you have, but just for sake of matter here, I don't use max tire width on my cars. I have a 350Z that has 265s, which I think the max is like 285 or something. My Mustang has 285s on it. I mean, you don't mean max tire width. So I don't want a lot of power. So this car can go up to 295 if you wish to do that, then by all means. But for the sake of this one, I'm going to build it at 265 and then 255. So I like to stagger. Now, some people like to do stock tire width in the front. I'm going to do that here as well. Tire composition. This one's a bit harder to explain, and it's all in what you feel. Some people prefer street tire composition. Some prefer sport. This is a no-no, and this is, if you're doing this, then you shouldn't be here. So street tires or sport tires are your best bets, sometimes stock. It all depends on the car. So for this BMW, I'm probably going to go with street tires because sport tires is a little too much grip for a car of this size. You also have to take into account the wheelbase. If you have a car that is longer, you might want a little extra grip. If you have a car with a short wheelbase, and it's harder to, lose grip and to actually initiate a drift, then you might want a worse composition. But I'll leave that up to you guys. I picked street for this one, so. So race clutch for quicker shifting, race transmission for quicker shifting, driveline just to lighten the weight. Differential to help you when you're drifting to keep those rear wheels either spinning at the same time or around the same rate. Now, when you choose wheels here, it doesn't matter. I prefer the my favorite, I think my favorite set is the Advan RG2, but on this car it doesn't look appropriate. I think what I chose for this car before was the Hammonds Race Edition, or Edition Race. Yep. Now, some people don't think that the actual width or the size of the rim, I call them wheels, but rim, sometimes I pick what looks good, and then you want a nice balance of tire wall and tire, like, if you, the more tire width you have, the more spread out or more contact with the ground your tires will have, but you also want to have that give and take, so I like to give it maybe about the middle, so I think 19 is the magic number for me. But, so that's everything from the ground. I'll go ahead and I did the transmission, or, oh wow, misclick, or mispress button, sorry. So that'll take me a minute to load that back up. Okay. So now on to brakes, race brakes. Most of you know the routine from here. You want to just throw that in, of course, lighten it all the way, blah, blah, blah. We know the whole shebang. Now, horsepower. What I try to do for this is I build what makes the car lighter first. So the manifold makes the car lighter. The exhaust makes the car lighter. Valves. And it's not significant weight loss, but it just helps me kind of grasp how much power. So we look at the power curve. The torque curve still looks decently flat. It looks like it kind of gets out of the way by maybe about, not even 50, like, about 50. So we see the car weighs 2,500-ish pounds, has a 50-50 weight distribution, 430 horsepower, 337 foot-pound of torque. So I think for this car, I could say that's kind of good, but, and then my disclaimer is when I build a car, I never put cams in it, because look what it does to this graph. Your RPMs are higher, but I just don't like that. You're like, I have 600 horsepower, but 200 foot-pound of torque, so your tires are going to be spinning, but you're not going to be putting any power down, so I leave it stock whenever I can. So I guess we can just, beef up 450, see it's 2,500 pounds, maybe, for me, I like to put my cars between 500 and 550 pounds, like, for example, my Spark, my 2000 Mustang Cobra has about between 500 and 550 horsepower. It's kind of that magical number right in there. I get the tire spin I want, but if I need to grip up just a little bit, I can let off the gas a little bit. And you also want enough power so when you're following somebody and they're not as fast and they go angle heavy, you have the option to go angle heavy as well. So, I mean, just for the sake of the cause, I think I'll leave it at 450 for now. So, I've done a quick rundown of what I do for cars with regards to what I pick and choose to build. This car doesn't weigh much. If you want to get all grippy happy, then by all means. I don't put Forza Aero on my car. One, it looks stupid more often than not. And then two, the wing just kind of looks displaced. It doesn't look like it belongs there. So there's that part. I didn't put the supercharger, the centrifugal supercharger in it, because when I drift, I try to prefer an NA motor. That's why I drift muscle cars, is because I don't need to wait for the turbo to kick in or wait for the... I have the power. As soon as I put the pedal down, the power is there. So I try to keep that in mind. Now, when I tune, I have a bass tune I have in my head. So for this, I tune around 24 in the front, 25 in the back. Now, sure, I'm disclosing all of my personal secrets. But gearing, I don't touch the gearing until I hit the track. That's when I start to test it. And see, third gear feels a little long. Maybe I should shorten it just to maybe a notch or two. Camber, this is all up to you guys. Sometimes it depends on the car's weight distribution as well as how smooth you are. Now, I drift on a wheel, so I don't need 5 degrees of camber. I know some people that are wheel drifters that do that. I don't. I prefer to keep it lower. So this is generally how I tune it. I'll tune it around 1-ish camber, and then I don't know why it's ticking that way. Okay, and I'll leave around there. And then some people like their caster really high. I like my caster somewhat low.
so I'll leave it around 2-ish. I don't touch the anti-roll bars because I really don't know what to do with those yet. I like my front a little stiffer, and then the back. Some people say they like it half the front or a third of the front. I kind of like to keep the back softer, and then, of course, lower it all the way. Dampening, you want it stiffer in the front. I drift with stiffer in the front, softer in the back. Not by a whole lot, but just enough that you can feel the difference. Now, braking, I don't have ABS. Now, some of you that drift with ABS, you'll feel a difference. When you have ABS and you press on the brakes, you still have control of your car. Your steering. You have control of your steering and whatnot. If you don't have ABS and you just flat out hit the brakes and you're in mid-drift while you hit that and you slam on the brakes, 90% of the time, you're just going to flat out spin out. So, I don't really touch the pressure. I'll adjust it by maybe about 5%, 10%. Nothing too dramatic. I generally like to put it around between 45 to 50% just to kind of... But this car is so well-balanced, I might put it at 49, 50. But for the sake of this, I'll leave it at 50. I like to leave it... And this is all personal, too. This is just stuff I do. I'll leave it around 80 to 60. So when you step on the gas, your wheels... It's hard to explain the differential. It's just something you feel. Ouch, I just totally jerked on my earmuffs. But when you're at 80% flooring it, your differential will start to spin the wheels around the same rate. So if you're flooring it, then the rear wheels will lock up and go together. It's the same thing for, rear. So I've tuned this somewhat, but all that fine tuning comes from when you drift on, just any track. So, I personally like to drift on either Silverstone National or Sunset Club, and the reason why is because the tracks are perfectly flat. Now, if you can dial in your car to a flat track, then when you go on other tracks, the tune does nothing but gets better. So this is stuff that I have found out and stuff that I've been taught. Now, here... It's just simple. So I don't have my headphones on right now, so I can't hear the motor. You'll probably hear it later. But, so just to kind of grasp and see how the car feels, like right now, I'm kind of actually liking the feel of this. You're probably hearing the vibration of my controller. Some people will talk about, oh, you're not getting enough angle, blah, whatever you need. You get what angle you can to keep your speed up enough to go around a track. Because, I mean, what's the point of going, literally, I will demonstrate this for you. Okay, I'm not drifting right here, I don't care. That's not the point. It's up here. Okay.
So I tested on... So I'm going to put my headset on so I can hear the motor. Sometimes hearing the motor makes it all better.
Okay. I like the sound of this motor. Okay, so we initiate. But, like, here. I'll do it right here. Some people, it's like you get angle to go inside, outside. Yes, I straightened up there. So if you're like, I'm going to get a ton of angle... Look what happens. You're cutting in and wrecking your car. Now, unfortunately, this is on simulation, so my tranny just officially got boned. So I will restart it. But you find the right balance with angle and speed. You want enough angle to make your opponent behind you have to work a lot harder for it. Of course, you want to be like... We all want to be like... Check it out, man. I got like 70 degrees of angle and I can hold it. You can't in this game. The track's layout prevents you from doing that. And literally the physics of the cars themselves only allows you to hold about maybe 45 degrees of angle, if not less, consistently holding it. Now sure, some people will go, well, lightning, you can throw it in reverse in 90. Yes, you can throw it in reverse in 90, but you can only hold it for a split second or two before it becomes ineffective to have that much angle because you're going to be going around a corner like, oh, look, 90. But then you're like, wow, I just lost all that speed. I have to carry it to the next corner. So, but like I said before I wrecked my car, I said, don't get too much angle. There's times and places to get a lot of angle. Like here, when you're about to finish a run, you're like, oh, I'm going to push my car to the limits and freaking graze that wall like a pro and kill that sign like a mass murderer. But testing on the flat track helps you dial in your camber and your tire. And I like to keep my tire pressure low because look, I'm flooring it, I'm drifting around, and my tires are about 32 psi, which is the optimal level of psi for drifting. Ideal amount of grip as well as lack of, wow, okay, that was completely me monologuing like a, and yes, I have the vibration on my controller, so you can hear absolutely everything, or wheel, sorry, wheel. But you want to find that ideal balance. I'll conclude this as my first episode. I will call the series Keeping It Sideways. And then I will put the late name of the car next to it. So I hope you guys enjoy this first episode. I actually kind of like this tune already the way it is. I don't think there's any adjustments. The gearing actually kind of fits the torque curve precisely. If you want, you can always make fine tunes and fine adjustments to it. So, wow, I have toe in. That's it. That's the first car. That's the first tune. Yes, I want to save the changes. But go ahead and leave in the comment section below. Go ahead and leave a request for the next car that I am going to do. And then I will get on my next Challenge Lightning Hiro video, my next Let's Do This video. And be sure to keep, if you guys want to know more about me or just curious as to why I'm doing what I do and why I do the things I do, leave some questions below and I'll be sure to save them. I have a Word document right now that I'm saving where I save it, so I save questions and then I can go over, play a video, and then go back, open that Word document, and read the questions and answer them to the best of my ability, within reason. So I don't want to reveal too much because I'm me. I like to keep me to myself. So yes, I talk a lot, but hopefully you guys can understand that. So anyways, I'm done here. This is the first episode. This is the BMW Z4. So I hope you guys enjoyed it. Let me know. Otherwise, I'll see you guys next time.